welcome back to Campus Crossfire. Well, now, we promised it before the break, we're going to get into it. Closing military bases, there's a lot of call right now. Back in 2005, we had, to update everyone, there was a Base Realignment and Closure Commission, which their big job was to determine in the post Cold War world and things like that, what bases need to be kept open and which ones need to be closed and where we needed certain forces. Well, a big thing like that is there's more push. As, I mean, the national debt is increasing, we are seeing more and more of spending cuts and things like that, and part of that comes with bases. But Congress is really resisting closing bases because they don't want to lose the jobs in their district. So what do you guys think? Should Congress cave and allow the Department of Defense to close some bases, or stand their ground and refuse to allow the closures? Drew, what do you think?
I think that they should close the bases.
Well, it's not every base. It's
not
just
every,
a few,
but
it's
the
a
bases that they, you know, are trying to. Because, I mean, like you said about, should we spend money for the need of the country, or should we spend money, you know,
for the needs of individual districts?
Yeah, exactly. I mean, if we don't need them, I think it's ridiculous to have so many bases.
Why do you think that we don't need them?
I mean, if it's post-Cold War, like, if it's bases that were used, you know.
Yeah. I don't know. I feel that they should stand their ground.
Okay.
Honestly, that's just what I feel for that issue. I mean,
why do you think they should stand their ground? I mean, to defend their constituents, keep their seats in Congress. What do you think?
To keep the seats in Congress, essentially.
All right, let it be known to the world that Rhea Claypool, you should do anything and everything you need to do to stay in your seat in Congress. So, no.
It's a cold world out here. I mean,
I disagree with that. I mean, like, if you're just trying to keep your seat in Congress, then are you really, you know.
Okay. Well, keeping with some of these topics and things like that, the 24-hour study space bill passed in the Associated Student Government Senate last night. And a big part of that was we're all college students. We all know that there's nights when you've got a big paper or a big test coming up the next day and you want to be up all night. But I could just do that in my apartment because I don't have a roommate. But a lot of people have roommates or they live in a dorm or things like that. And it isn't as convenient. So they need 24-hour study space. And a bill passed last night supporting it. We don't know if it's going to be implemented yet. But do you guys think there was really a need for that? Or was there not? It was just for a certain few people and kind of adjusting the whole status quo?
I would like to first commend our ASU president because I think he's doing a really good job this year. And I feel that it is very much needed. Me, last year, I lived in a house with three other roommates. And it was times where I wanted to pull an all-nighter and study for a big exam, but I couldn't because I had people in my house. So I would go to the library, and of course, it would be closed around 2 or 3. So where do I go to study and be in a quiet environment?
Okay. Drew, what do you think about this?
I would have to disagree with that. I think, you know, the library being open until 2 o'clock in the morning is perfectly fine. I mean, if you can't really study in your dorm room, then, I mean, find like a quiet space. Like, I live in an apartment. I have three roommates, but, you know, my room is a quiet space and I can go study. I think 24 hours just like pushing it a little too far. But if it is just like a small, like, area for 24 hours, I think that's, I mean, it's reasonable, but I don't think it's necessary.
Well, the big opposition to this last night in the Senate was that it would allow for the needs of the very, very few to kind of supersede the needs of the many, including the library employees or employees who would have to kind of supervise that. Do you guys think that the student government should be really working towards that, or whether or not they should be kind of focusing on the greater good?
Just me personally, I feel like that it is necessary for them to focus on that. Mm-hmm. Of course, education is first, and I feel like people who may have part-time jobs or even non-traditional students who have children and families, they need that extra time to go and study. So ASG presenting this bill and trying to go ahead and get these extra study hours in is definitely a good idea.
I mean, you made a really good point there, but also, I mean, looking at the employees' standpoint, I mean, not many people are going to want to work, you know, 24 hours, you know, in libraries. I mean, we have that period during like finals week where they could stay there because the library is open for like 24 hours.
So you want them to wait until finals and cram while they're working and try to have extra study hours?
I mean, I don't think that's true, but at the same time, like, you have to look at the employees and think about them. Some of the employees are actually, you know, student workers and
hey, they'd love it if they were trying to stay up to study for an all-nighter, get paid while doing it. I mean, it's a double bonus.
I mean, study and get paid.
That's true, but I also think that, I mean, it would be less people on board for that. I don't think as many people really want to do that, or employees want to do that.
All right, guys. Now, you guys brought it up earlier with some of the healthcare discussions we were having, but you mentioned just a few questions I had about that. You mentioned that there's really no job loss. And my one question to you guys about that is, this is going to cause a cost for employers to increase with the employer mandate that's going to come into effect in the next couple of years, mm-hmm. been delayed again. Mm-hmm. But would increased costs cause employee numbers to go down for the company? Do you think that would be a big cause of that? Or what do you think, Drew?
I think if it does cause for jobs to be lost, it's pretty much the company's fault. I don't think the company cannot afford to have, you know, like the mandate for like small mm-hmm. businesses having to give their employees like healthcare. I don't think it will actually like really affect them that much. I think it's more so they're trying to say that it will affect them. So they will make people lose their jobs, you know, so we don't have to implement this like healthcare.
Okay.
Just touching on what Drew said, I agree with her, and I feel like a lot of companies already offer these healthcare benefits, and I feel like it won't really affect a lot of companies, and it'll be perfectly fine. I just feel like people get out of hand when it comes to healthcare and Obamacare and really exaggerate.
Okay. Well, I mean, it's a question we've brought up to you, Ray, a couple of times in our previous shows, and it's about the upcoming midterm elections that we have in 2014. And the biggest thing about that is the Republicans are really pushing the Affordable Care Act and Obamacare as the reason to not re-elect Democrats that are up for re-election. Do you see that as continuing to be a big focus, or do you see anything else kind of creeping up with that?
I feel like it won't be a big focus. I feel like it's here to stay and it's going to stay here. They can keep on pushing, but I feel like they won't make a big effort.
Okay, Drew, what do you think?
I agree with you. I can't really think of anything else that's like really trying to, or like the Republicans are really trying to like push or make the Democrats look bad. But I think the whole focus on Obamacare is gonna start like fizzling out. I think people are understanding that, I mean, you know, it's part of our system now, like we, you know, just have to accept it.
And it would be nice if the Republicans actually offered a plan that was similar to Obamacare.
Okay.
I guess go with their side, but they haven't, so.
All right, well, it's time for you two to offer your versions of what's one of our favorite viewer segments, and that is your rants. Rhea, do you have anything for us tonight?
Yes, I really want to talk about the possible increase of minimum wage. This has been a topic that's been talked about amongst a lot of people. And yes, it would boost the incomes of low-wage paying people, but also people have the possibility of losing their jobs. Higher raising minimum wage, that will have to increase payroll for employers, and it may cut jobs and reduce worker hours and curb summer hiring. So, I mean, minimum wage goes up, but me being a college student, I might not get a summer job because an employee might not want to pay me more. So I just feel like that's something that's really bothering me, and I feel like minimum wage should not be raised because it's going to cause a lot of other problems, and it just stays how it is.
Okay. Drew, you got anything for us?
Yeah. Okay. All right. It's like a personal opinion, and I would like to talk about feminism, and I think that this country should push towards feminism a lot more. It has been over the years, but you know, as a hardworking college student, a woman at that, I think that it's important to focus on how we should encourage women to get in the workforce and have families at the same time, and just really, you know, show that women are just as capable of men and doing great jobs.
All right, thank you both for that wonderful bit. We are going to go to break. When we come back, we will have two new panelists ready to go for you. Stay with us, Campus Crossfire. I'll be right back.